So, good afternoon, everybody. I must say I feel extremely privileged to speak at this meeting, honoring a great theory by a great scientist. And I'm also grateful to the organizing committee to make this possible. So it has been a very nice and informative meeting so far. And I'm happy to have all these great-minded, spirited persons around me. So this is the thermal Young-Mills action in its classical form. Beta is the inverse of temperature. And I'll try to give you a little glimpse in my talk of what beautiful ideas and results this, by now, simple and very familiar-looking action leads to. So first of all, very brief motivation why there is a need for a non-perturbative approach to, say, SU2 Young-Mills theory. We know that small coupling expansions are plagued by instabilities in the soft magnetic sector. That is, soft magnetic gluons are screened too weakly to give a sensible, non-alternating convergence of the perturbation theories. And I think it's also fair to say that there are finite spatial volume issues in lattice simulations at high temperatures. So in order to understand this a little bit better, I think it's very much justified to look at the theory in a non-perturbative way, constructing a thermal ground state out of topologically non-trivial configurations, and then look what the physics above this ground state is. So again, this is the action. And there were a lot of mentions about the commutator term and the field strength being important for the field strength to transform as a homogeneous quantity such that the trace of its square is actually gauge invariant. An important observation is that self-dual field configurations saturating the action in the sense of a lowest bound in a given topological sector immediately lead to the conclusion that the energy momentum tensor identically vanishes. So whatever these configurations are and whatever we use them to coarse grain into a thermal ground state, the effect of that must be a non-propagating field. So that is probably not as known as the fact that self-duality obviously implies the configuration to be a solution to the Euler Lagrange equations of the theory. And at finite temperature, we have to insist that the gauge field is periodic in time. Topological field configurations in the sense of self-dual configurations are stabilized by non-trivial binding. That has been brought forward a lot of times in this meeting. So there is another way of saying this. Non-trivial P3 of SU2 being set stabilizes these configurations. We are in particular interested in calorons, self-dual configurations at finite temperatures, obeying periodicity constraints at winding number unity. So the most easy way of constructing such configurations is by going to singular gauge. And it has been known for a long time, discovered by Atoft, Rabi, and Chakif, that in singular gauge, the gauge potential is actually functional of a scalar prepotential. That scalar prepotential pi enjoys superposition properties. So you can construct yourself a configuration of charge K out of configurations of charge 1 by superimposing the appropriate prepotentials and therefore getting the charge K configurations. By work of Gross, Pisarski, and Jaffe, we know that for the charge 1 case in an S1 R3 strip of R4, we have the behavior of the prepotential is actually identical to the one of a singular gauge instanton as you go close to the instanton center, space-time-wise. As you leave the instanton center for large spatial separations, configuration itself becomes static, and the length scale telling you what is small and large in terms of spatial distance is just given by the scale parameter of the instanton divided by beta. So as I said, as you go far away spatially from the instanton center, you run into static configurations that are actually characterized by self-dual dipoles. The dipole moment of these dipoles is again given by the spatial separation scale S. On the other hand, going very close to the instanton center, we can conclude that the topological charge is actually localized at the instanton center in the sense that the term Simons current integrated over an S3 arbitrarily small but centered at the instanton center is saturated. So we can conclude that topological charge in a singular gauge situation is extremely localized. There's another way of constructing Clairons of topological charge 1 due to Werner Naam and explicitly being put forward by Li and Lu, Gran, Van Baal 15 years later, which are Clairons of so-called non-trivial holonomy, meaning that the A4 field of the Clairon at spatial infinity reaches constancy in such a way that you create magnetic substructure in a solution. So you generate magnetic monopole, anti-monopoles in a solution in terms of an apparent gauge symmetry breaking SU2 to U1. And these monopoles are charged with respect to the unbroken U1. Interestingly enough, the spatial separation scale between these centers is again given by scale S that I already mentioned for the trivial holonomy case. So these configurations are characterized by monopole masses depending on the holonomy U. They are unstable under Gaussian fluctuations. And this was shown in an heroic effort by Dyakonov about 10 years ago. Unfortunately, Dyakonov died 2 years ago, so I'm extremely sad about this because he was a very brilliant and talented and forceful truth seeker in our field. Yes. So Dyakonov's result actually tells you that there's monopole, anti-monopole attraction in the case of small holonomies. Remember, on a classical level, the solution was self-dual, but it's instable by Gaussian fluctuations, made instable by not having an exact cancellation between A4 field-mediated repulsion and AI field-mediated attraction in a monopole anti-monopole system. Yeah, so quantum fluctuations distort this balance. Okay, on the other hand, in the case of a large holonomy, there is monopole anti-monopole repulsion, meaning that the Clairon actually dissociates into its constituents. So the former situation is extremely likely, happens all the time, but the latter situation is extremely unlikely, just by a thermodynamical Boltzmann-Weight argument. The locus of the action of these non-trivial Clairons is, again, the instanton center, so there's an S3 winding situated in a point, and the trivial holonomy limit actually renders one of the monopoles massless, while the other monopole becomes maximal mass, meaning that you have a stable situation. So if something's smeared across the spatial universe, there's nothing to collapse. All right, so coming back to the statement I made in the beginning, we want a thermal ground state. We want to construct a ground state out of non-propagating field configurations that tells us what is really happening at high temperatures. So connecting to the previous speaker, I forgot the first speaker. He said, if you have a Wilson line, we can throw in some algebra at some points, right? And that's getting interesting then, because you get these junctions in the Wilson line, and that's exactly what we're doing here. So we take the field strengths, connected at zero, spatially connected with the Wilson line to field strengths at some finite distance away from the origin, and come back with the Wilson line connecting to the origin. And there's some piece of algebra in terms of the field strengths and an explicit generator in this definition. So I assure you, in terms of a dimensionless quantity, and also in terms of deformations of this definition having higher charge Clairons contribute, and higher endpoint functions contribute to the integration, this is a unique definition. You cannot write anything else but this if you want to have a dimensionless, a jointly transforming family of phases. So the family of phases that we are after here is actually not really the scalar field that we are looking for, but it's just defining the kernel of a differential operator that thereby is uniquely defined. So in executing this definition, you run into a lot of interesting observations. First of all, it's only magnetic-magnetic correlations that make this non-trivial. So remember, perturbation theory was plagued by a soft magnetic sector being insufficiently screened. With field configurations that are never approachable in perturbation theories, you see it's exactly this sector that contributes to non-trivial behavior. What comes out of the calculation is that you indeed get your kernel, and the kernel coincides with the kernel of this linear differential operator being two-dimensional in each polarization state. So you have a unique definition of the operator in terms of its kernel. So if you want to write down an effective action, this operator being linear should, as a consequence of the action principle, annihilate the scalar field that we are after. I should also mention that the integration over the scale parameter, color and scale parameter, is sharply dominated at whatever the cutoff of this integration will be. So it's only a very thin slice of scale parameters that contribute to a non-trivial result. Okay, now I told you about this operator being linear and basically a harmonic oscillator operator, right? But it has the caveat of having an explicit temperature dependence in it. Since the action of a Calderon is basically just its topological charge, you must not allow in any kind of coarse graining and integrating over topological sectors, you must not allow for any explicit temperature dependence in the action density to occur. So the only way how you can get rid of this explicit temperature dependence in your effective dynamics is by postulating the existence of a potential for the field that absorbs this temperature dependence. So then the consistency of BPS and Euler Lagrange in the effective theory gives you an evolution equation for this potential, being first order. Solution to this evolution equation has one integration constant, which is a mass scale, and sneaks in as the Young-Mills scale. So that's a completely different mechanism of generating dimensional transmutation. We've learned a lot about dimensional transmutation in the course of this meeting, being basically associated with initial conditions to a running coupling constant. Here, we are talking about non-interacting calorons generating a dimensional transmutation in a sense that you have to prescribe a boundary condition for this evolution equation for the potential. And at the same time, you then quickly learn that the modulus of the scalar field, which is determined by this mass scale and temperature, is actually decaying with temperature like 1 over square root t. So in a sense, you recover, naively speaking, asymptotic freedom in a very non-perturbative way. No logarithmic decay in temperature, but power law decay. I just draw your attention to the fact that both equations, BPS and Euler Lagrange, have to be satisfied simultaneously. So if I write down the BPS equation, on the right-hand side of this equation, I get a square root of a potential other than a derivative of potential as we have it in the Euler Lagrange case. So that just prevents us from additively shifting the potential. So we have a unique way of defining a ground state energy in the end just because of the fact that Euler Lagrange and BPS have to be satisfied simultaneously. So no additive shifts of potential as you have it in Lagrangian, Euler Lagrangian field theory classically. So then the question is, that's of course not the whole story. We have only the field phi so far. And the question is, how do we have to complete the effective action in order to describe the whole story? So first of all, we have perturbative free normalizability. We know that coarse grading over the topological trivial sector must not generate any higher power in g squared than 1. That's the statement of perturbative free normalizability. Second is gauge invariance. Cannot be just an ordinary derivative acting on phi, but a covariant derivative being squared, and then the potential we just derived. You may wonder why there's no mixed operators to higher dimensionality, except for these for this mixing of the topological trivial sector and the phi field in the covariant derivative. And the answer is that these higher power operators would mediate momentum transfer to the scalar field phi, which by definition is excluded. It's an inert, non-propagating field which cannot mediate any momentum transfer. So that's it. That's the unique effective action that we can work with. And then the question is, of course, what are the implications? So the first implication is solve the Euler-Lagrange equation for the effective propagating sector and see that there's a pure gauge solution. Very simple pure gauge solution, being marked by the fact the covariant derivative on the solution vanishes, as well as the field strength. So what happens due to this ground state solution is that the ground state pressure and the energy density are elevated from zero in a pure BPS sector to something finite. And that, of course, has an interpretation microscopically due to Calderon overlap and transient holonomy shifts that I mentioned already. So negative pressure, linearly rising in temperature, and positive ground state energy density. Of course, entropy density is zero. Yeah? Equation of state tells you it has to be such. What about the spectrum? So from the effective action, you just read of the mass spectrum of the theory in terms of thermal quasi-particle masses by looking at this term. I mean, you just read it off from the action density. And in unitary gauge, which you can always reach, you get that two out of the three directions in the algebra actually acquire mass, which again is power-like decaying in temperature, if we can assume that this coupling is somehow constant at high temperature, which I will justify in a bit. And then there's a massless direction. Another way of seeing the emergence of mass in the effective theory is, of course, by a Dyson series, right? Having the propagating sector interact infinitely often with the background field phi generates mass. But by this very argument, you can exclude that the massive sector actually can ever be on-shell. Because whatever drives a pre-existing on-shell condition away from on-shellness has necessarily to provide for momentum transfer to the background field phi. That's excluded. So you can already say whatever the massive sector is trivial in the sense that it's only on-shell and thermally weighted propagating. Okay, so for to the mass spectrum, then you could just think about what the effective coupling really does at the level of non-interacting quasi-particles, and I will argue that this is a very good approximation to the real situation. So you just demand thermodynamic self-consistency, you demand stability of the one loop free quasi-particle pressure with respect to variations in mass. That gives you an evolution equation for the effective coupling, which is marked by the fact that you have a plateau precisely calculable and a logarithmically thin divergence at a finite temperature in dimensionless units 13.87. So why do we know about this precise value? We know that there is a small mass expansion of a non-analytic function, the pressure being non-analytic in mass squared, due to Dolan and Chekhov, a very controlled expansion. Non-analytic function is expanded in non-analytic terms, which, however, can be made arbitrarily small as mass is arbitrarily small. And that allows us to have a reliable approximation of the evolution equation giving this plateau value. So very important work that contributes to this. At the same time, we know that the ground state emergence, the emergence of the field phi, was dominated by scale parameters at the order of the cutoff. The cutoff in this effective theory is, of course, the modulus of the scalar field. So if you restore h bar as a real dimensionful quantity, a little bit of redefinition of the fields, very basic and routine, Brodsky has elaborated the argument again, but there's a lot of pre-work to that, just tells you that the effective coupling in its plateau behavior is actually proportional to 1 over square root of h bar. Okay? Now, since the ground state is dominated by calorons that are of scale of the cutoff, we can actually use the effective coupling in order to compute the fundamental coupling of a caloron. And that gives us an h bar. So having said all this, we can have a re-evaluation of the caloron anatomy, as I already superficially introduced it before. So again, there is a region, a space-time region around the origin, where the field strength is time-dependent. Spatial averaging over this region up to the cutoff scale renders the time dependence of the field strength into a time dependence of the effective field phi, which is merely a pure gauge. And then there is an external peripheral region in space where there's dipole behavior of the field strength, which is static. Action is localized in this point. action was supposed to be H-bar, as we just learned. So a little summary of what I said. So out of a classical Euclidean thermal action, classical, I derive an effective theory whose vertices and whose thermal distributions are characterized by H-bar. So small holonomy Calorons in the effective, contributing to the effective theory actually constitute a thermal ground state that I just mentioned. And you can also argue mediate vertices, local vertices in the effective fields. There is a strong set of kinematic constraints in a totally fixed gauge, unitary Coulomb. So I told you there's a U1 gauge symmetry left after the adjoint Higgs field becoming effective. This unitary, so you can go to unitary gauge where the adjoint Higgs field is just a constant. And you can gauge the U1 part in Coulomb gauge, right? That gives you extremely physical, an extremely physical gauge. And so your conditions, your kinematic conditions, are extremely physically implemented. Yeah? Basically, what you want is that no momentum transfer in effective theory can be larger than the phi field itself, because that prescribes the cutoff. Physical and fixed. And then I just tell you now that you can, of course, look at the expansion of any thermodynamical quantities in terms of loops. So there is, say, order one correction to the pressure, three quasi-particles, the massless modes, the two massive modes. There's radiative corrections to the pressure at two loops, and there's radiative correction at three loops. And you see that there's an extremely nice convergence of this expansion. Yeah? And the point I'm trying to conjecture here is that this expansion even truncates in terms of irreducible loops. So this is just saying that the number of constraints as a function of the loop order is overwhelming the number of loop variables as you go to a finite and not too high loop order, actually. So that's, of course, no proof, yeah, because we have algebraic varieties and not, yeah, so we have intersections of thick hypersurfaces that we have to look at if we really want to evaluate a given loop diagram. So that's not a proof, but it's a conjecture that might be provable at some point. So what we see right now is just an extreme numerical evidence that this is a good expansion. So that justifies why I calculate the effective coupling at one loop level only, because the corrections are just so tiny. All right, so what about real world implications? So if we assume, and I'll justify this if I have the time a little later, that SU2-Young-Mills theory has something to do with thermal photons, as they are in the cosmic microwave background, for instance, then this SU2-Young-Mills theory, in terms of its abelian charges, has to be dually interpreted. And the argument goes like this. Just look at the fine structure constant being the electric charge divided by 4 pi times h. If I work in units, with C and KB are equal to unity. That quantity has to be unitless in any system of dimensions, right? So in particular, in this one, for alpha to be unitless, as I said, this electric coupling here, the square of it, must cancel the power of h bar in the denominator, right? But since we know that our effective electric coupling is 1 over square root of h bar, we have to assume that whatever is the electric coupling in the real world is actually the magnetic coupling in the Young-Mills theory. Yeah, so if I plug this in here, I get a square root of h bar up here, right? And then that cancels the power of h bar in alpha. So SU2, if it really has to do something with the real world in terms of photons, has to be electric magnetically dually interpreted. So an electric monopole, in a magnetic monopole in the Young-Mills theory is actually an electric monopole, and so on and so forth. So let's see how the concept of the thermal ground state actually carries on if we want to describe the propagation of isolated plane waves above or through this ground state. So as I told you, there is a magnetic and electric dipole at Calorón center distances peripheral. And I can just compute the density of these dipoles by having the dipole moment here and dividing it by the coarse graining volume. That happens to be proportional to square root of t. At the same time, an isolated plane wave propagating in the ground state must be characterized by the energy density of the ground state. Right? So that gives us an E field, oh yeah, an E field modulus that's also proportional to square root of T. So dividing these two things in order to get the electric permittivity of the ground state gives a temperature independent quantity, and that's already quite consistent. I'd say that's a good sign. The thermal ground state concept can be actually carried away from the original realm of where it was supposed to work. All right, so I promised to you that there's a little bit of evidence, maybe 5 minutes, I'm not sure, I have to run through it, that indeed SU2 is a candidate for describing thermalized photon systems. So the biggest photon system that's thermalized in our universe is the cosmic microwave background, right? So we'd rather look for anomalies in this microwave background in order to fix, first of all, the scale of our theory, and then make predictions. So the scale fixing is done by looking at the low frequency spectrum of the present cosmic microwave background, having an excess in spectral power. That's a solid experimental factual thing. People have done terrestrial observations for 20 years almost. There was a dedicated RKD2 experiment, balloon-borne, that reinvestigated the issue, and they came to the conclusion there's indeed a very strong excess at very low frequencies. And our explanation of this is actually that the SU2 theory, if it is valid to describe photons, is at the phase boundary to a so-called pre-confining phase where a Meissner effect happens. So the Meissner effect renders the massless, formerly massless sector slightly massive at low frequencies, introducing evanescent modes that are spectrally totally differently redistributed compared to the Rayleigh-Jeans law at low frequencies. So the details I cannot give you here. There's papers which, if you're interested, you can read. Another three-level situation or prediction or confrontation with reality is a violation of conformal temperature scale factor scaling. With scale factor, the scale factor means the cosmic scale factor. So at low temperatures, meaning low redshifts, there is a pronounced violation of this TA relation, just being signaled by this curved curve with respect to the standard straight line. And then there is a quick recovery at higher redshifts, say redshift 10, to the conformal scaling situation again. And if you use this, you can actually resolve a discrepancy between extracting the redshift for reionization of the universe coming from the angular CMB power spectrum versus a spectral anomaly that's associated with early quasar spectra, the so-called Gunn-Peterson 2. So the later tells you Z has to be equal to 6. The former tells you Z equals 11 with an arrow of order unity. We resolve this by invoking this breaking of conformal scaling. There's predictions, of course. This is now a one-loop effect. So you calculate the polarization tensor of the theory, and you know now what the scale of the theory is, right? It was 10 to the minus 4 eV just by fixing it in terms of this little bump. And you say that at, say, 5.4 Kelvin, twice the temperature of the CMB today, I'm sorry, you get a spectral gap in the spectral distribution. So Rayleigh-Jeans is a parabola, you get a gap, and you get a little bit of anti-screening, which, however, exponentially fast approaches the Planck curve. So this can be measured. Then there is an integral manifestation of the spectral anomaly, which is just the difference in energy density between SU2 and U1, the standard theory, being a positively sloped quantity with a slope that is very quickly decaying. And there's a dedicated paper just explaining how this positive slope actually biases negative temperature fluctuations at late time. So these negative temperature fluctuations are, according to what I argue here, related to large angle anomalies that we observe in the CMB. Cold spot, power asymmetries, axis of evil, preferred direction in aligning multipoles, and so on and so forth. I cannot go into the detail. And then there is some signature having to do with longitudinally propagating modes. They're also in the polarization tensor. Since we have a dual interpretation of the theory, these are actually not electric modes, but magnetic modes. And so if you have a slight breaking of isotropy, which you do have, then this gets turned into coherent fields, magnetic fields. And so the question is not answered definitely by any means. I mean, that's just a speculation that this has to do with intergalactic magnetic fields. So also a late time effect. You know? Okay, so a little summary. I argued that there has to be a high temperature alternative to perturbation theory. I told you very briefly how Calorons being BPS saturated configurations in Young-Mills theory can be used to construct a thermal ground state that's characterized by an inert adjoint scalar field breaking the original gauge symmetry to U1. I told you about the effective theory, which is very much fixed. I mean, you cannot tinker. Effective coupling evolution, the Calorón action turns out to be H-bar. There's a Calorón mediation. Isolated Calorons pop out of the ground state to mediate vertices in the effective theory. That's not a new idea. Toft had this idea about 30 years ago in the realm of the Landau, Lassigneau model. What was the first name? Lassigneau model? Anyway, I forgot. So the Toft vertex, right, being mediated by the zero modes of fermions being localized on instantons, that's a similar idea here. So we have an electric magnetic dual interpretation of the theory. The effective radiations are extremely well controlled. If we assume that the theory has to do something with photons, there's tree-level and one-loop polarization anomalies that manifest themselves in terms of CMB anomalies. So cosmic radio background that I mentioned, quasar versus CMB with respect to reionization. So there's a discrepancy in extracting a redshift. There's a spectral integral blackbody anomaly, which presumably, and I'd say not quite unlikely, has to do with the CMB anomalies at large angles. And then there might be a link to the extragalactic magnetic fields. So I took the freedom to give you a couple of references if you're interested. So that book, by the way, was sold in the last break here. So anyway, it's available. Thank you.
Well, you have somehow very rapidly say calculation about many loops. Mm-hmm. Is it real loop diagrams? Is it real Green functions dependent on some your field? Or?
So it's an expansion of the pressure that we did. Mm-hmm. There's very
four-dimensional integrals with singular Green functions.
Sure. But subject to all these kinematics constraints that I mentioned. So it's really not an integrating over a very compact manifold or anything. I mean, you never integrate over compact manifolds anyway in perturbation theory, but a very filiated manifold.
Yeah. Well, I ask because in Young-Mills, of course, which I described, for instance, the three loop was very expensive, very
difficult. It is also complicated here. So the three loop calculation you do with Monte Carlo techniques. I mean, you it's just too high dimensional, the phase space that you have to consider.
Okay, very good.
Two loop is okay. What do you mean by gauge length? Yes, that's what you mean. Okay. That's a very good question. So you start at a conformally invariant theory, and you integrate over straight lines, therefore, because you don't have any other scale at your disposal at this level to deform a straight line into something that has curvature, right? But in principle, you are saying about the length. You're asking about the length, so the length is a variable, right, which is integrated over. And the interesting thing, having a parameter family emerge out of this definition, is the observation that an angular integral here, together with a radial integral, gives you something indefinite, a real parameter only. Yeah? So you have one parameter that spans the kernel of having an infinity times zero being undetermined.
Okay, wait. When you say SU2 photon, what is the origin of SU2? That SU2 come from standard model? Do you have?
No, it's just an extension of the U1y of the standard model to something non-abelian. But it's a good question, certainly, right? Justified by the fact that the interaction of the photon with the massive sector, effective massive sector, is so feeble that you just... Yeah, I mean, we just thought about the most manageable ones right now. But in principle, you have to think about what happens to your standard model later on. Sure. Thank you.